I sighted the microphone for the green light to the speed trap. Ray Garino and Jody calls them as they seize them, and you better believe them. Here, relevant news, biased opinion, and outright nonsense regarding every aspect of automotive culture. Gasp! With mechanical trickery never before broadcast over FCC regulated airwaves. Thrilled to the explosive tension as Ray and Joe cuss each other down track. Barrel roll across the finish line, laughing at certain disaster as they shake hands with the devil. All that and so much more at high noon this Sunday on the Motormouth Radio Hour. Call in and speak live with the Wizards of Speed and the Live Eat, Ray Garino and Joe D. Bring the whole family. Kids under 12 get in free every Sunday at noon on WHPC. Take the Hempstead Turnpike to the Meadowbrook Parkway and look for the no parking on the expressway and no express service on the parkway side. Go right on Highway 24 to Garden City. $2 all-day parking includes pit pass. Even!
Yeah, you may be living for the sun, for the fun, for the grunge, if that's the case. You found
the humidity.
It. Yep, you found it here on Motormouth Radio, Long Island's only automotive talk show with your hosts, Ray Guarino, co-host Wingman, and guy over there.
The other guy.
Joe D.
Yay.
And he's basking in the sun himself today.
Yep.
Having all sorts of fun. And we are here to talk about your automotive concerns, complaints, and repair issues. We're going to have a we're going to have a good guest today, Mr. Jim Lindsey from the Starbright Corporation.
Yeah.
The makers of Star-Tron and...
Star-Tron.
Many other things. If you go to starbright.com and look at their web catalog, it's ridiculous.
They got some great stuff. I always thought it was a lot of giant robots.
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean? Like, but then, you know, the Megatron and Star-Tron. And, you know.
I think they're all cousins.
Yeah, they're all Trons.
But, yeah, we'll be talking to Jim in a little while. Until then, you can get us on the phone, 516-572-7440. And you can follow us on our website, motormouthradio.com. And Twitter, the same address, and on Joe's favorite Instagram.
Real_MotormouthRadio.
Right, and you'll see.
That's that little key right up here next to the zero, I think. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
But you hit the shift, okay.
And you can see what we do during the week, which is, you know, one of the last things I put up just the other day was a brake malady on a Dodge Ram.
Yeah.
You know, Joe and I just discussed this.
I only rammed it to you there.
Yeah. The thing you want to do is you want to go check this out. You see the pictures. It was a Dodge Ram rolling 35,000 miles on it, and late model truck, and all the brake pads were frozen into the caliper brackets.
Right.
In other words, the pistons on the caliper would move because the slide pins were okay, and the pistons were fine, but the pads couldn't move because they were, unless they were, you know, on the supreme, the truck stopped, obviously. And, of course, one of the pads was down to bare metal, and this is why you want to have your vehicles inspected. I asked the owner, I said, hey, when was the last time you had this inspected? And I was waiting to hear, like, yeah, last week, you know. And he said, no, it's due now. And I said, okay, good, because whoever inspected this should have failed it. And he goes, what do you mean? And then I showed him the bad brake parts and said, I was waiting to see if it had been done, and it was, you know, not done.
But done.
Anyway.
It was done.
Yeah. Let's go to the phones and see if we have another concern. We'll say hi. You're on with the Motor Mouths.
My brothers, I want to talk about pushrod love.
Pushrod love. Pushing and pushing.
Well,
pushrod love, gentlemen. I had an experience this week of pushrod love, and I want to tell you a little bit about it.
Oh,
I hope this isn't going in a bad place.
Ray, as soon as he starts talking about lubrication, hit the dump button.
Exactly.
I'm serious.
You're on your best behavior, young man.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay. I will, Uncle. I will. Here's what happened. I got to tell you, this is just extraordinary to me. I had to call up my brothers on the airwaves and let them know this.
Of course.
I was going to call you last week because my car had a bad case of Parkinson's disease.
Really?
Yeah, it was like that's what it was doing.
Oh, I thought it couldn't park.
Hey, wait, do that again.
Yeah, what was that noise?
Okay.
Okay.
So you were making James Bond martinis, shaking nuts.
And it was idling. It was just giving like this stutter, this shake that I just could not get rid of. So I said, you know what? What will the motor mouths do? And I went, probably nothing. But no, nonetheless was I did a compression check on it. And I found that seven cylinders were fantastic on the big block 383. But was there was one cylinder that was giving me zero compression. What?
I was going to say, did the needle actually point to a number that point to fantastic as opposed to meh?
Yeah.
Or
no. I was getting anywhere between 120 and 125 pounds.
Excellent. Okay. Thank you. All right.
The last cylinder eight, gave me zero. Zero.
Yeah.
So I pulled the valve cover, and I found one push rod was not where it was supposed to be.
Oh.
The push rod.
Unauthorized coffee break.
Yes, the push rod was in with the other push rod.
Oh, so there was push rod love.
Yes.
Not
you
good.
Can't deny our love. Our push rods were meant to be together.
They were.
Oh, how redneck.
Wow.
Yeah, so I went, this is not good.
Congratulations.
With index finger in the air, I said, this is not good.
Right.
Dun, dun, dun.
Right. Found them. Found the push rods in the same section, orifice. I don't know, whatever you want to call it. Mm. So what I had to do was, I figured, order new push rods, which I did.
Okay.
And I put new push rods in on the odd side, 1, 3, 5, and 7, put new push rods there.
Right.
But on the even side, what I did was I took the old push rods and put them in the two old push rods from one side of the engine. I put them in on the other side because I wasn't going to bend new push rods if something was jammed or stuck.
Okay.
So I stuck them in.
I see the logic.
Cranked the engine by hand.
Okay.
Yes.
Good idea.
By hand. And one of the lifter, how can I explain this? As I'm cranking, I got a little bit of bind, and I'm like, ugh, this is not good. And all of a sudden, I watched the valve and the spring just go dink, and it started to move.
Ah.
I'm like, oh, that's a good thing.
What did it do?
It went dink.
Oh, okay.
And started to move. So I sprayed it with more oil.
As opposed to
sprayed it with a little bit more oil, and I kept turning the engine by hand.
Right.
And it was moving. I was like, this is great. I don't know what.
Excellent.
I still don't know what happened. This car is one big, fat, silly mystery. I still don't know what happened.
It's varnish.
It must have been.
Yeah, seriously, yeah.
It goes to show you can't keep a good Mopar down either.
Mm-hmm.
That's for sure. Oh, I am literally with you on that completely, right? Because this thing is, I expected it to be catastrophic at that moment. I'm thinking in my head, I'm going to be pulling the heads off this thing, getting to the motor, and finding a hole in the piston because I have like zero compression. I'm like, right. Zero. Yeah. Who the heck has zero compression?
Mr. Stewart,
guys that have valves stuck open do, yeah.
Yeah, so that's what it was. And what I did was I ran the engine with the old push rods in it. I figured, let me just start this thing up. And I ran it for a little bit. I think I sent you the video of it, the 1 minute it was running.
Mm-hmm.
And I tell you, the lifters were cackling.
Right.
They were ticking and talking, and I'm like, please quiet down, please. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Just on that one cylinder, I'm like, please quiet down, please quiet down. I just said, gave it the Vulcan oil in the lifter probe on it. I was like staring at it, the brain thing, please.
Little telekinesis there, yeah.
And I got to say, just to back up a little bit, your video quality, really, it sucks. You know, either your phone is from the Stone Age, or you got to increase that file.
The oil was splattering on the phone lens.
Is that what it was?
It's either that or he was drooling again, one of the two.
No,
I'm so happy.
I must have set it to economy when I went and processed the video. I'll send you a higher quality version of that later. So you can see the smoke pouring from the valve covers.
Oh, yeah.
Because I just hand-tightened the valve covers. That was really it. I wasn't going to, because I knew I was going to get back in there and put the new rods in. So
what was the cost of all the repair parts?
Not a heck of a lot.
Right. That's
really not a heck of a lot. The rods, I think, cost me under $40 delivered, dropped right at the front door.
Nice.
Valve cover gaskets. I bought valve cover gaskets. I swear to you, I think they were dried out.
Yeah.
They must have been sitting on a shelf for I can't tell you how long.
Sure.
Which is another topic that I wanted to bring up. Buying parts for old Chryslers that have been sitting on a shelf for 30 years.
You know, old anything. Just insert name there. You're right.
Yes.
You're right.
I'm looking at the balcony against it. They're like rocks.
Yeah. New old stock, like Joe said, has become old stock now.
Right.
Joe's right. You're right, Joe.
Decrepit old stock is more like
I'm
it.
DOC.
I saw it here. I saw the guy at the auto parts store. He went in the back. He comes back with the Felpros. He drops them down. And I'm like, oh, great. You got them in stock. That's awesome. And he's a man of few words. You know, he just looks at you and grunts. I bring them home all happy. I go take them out of the box, and they're kind of hard.
Yeah.
I'm like, this is weird.
Mm-hmm.
So what I did was I put them in, and I couldn't get them to seat. Mm-hmm. I could not. It was still dripping a little bit of oil. Still getting oil out of them. So I did your trick, Ray. I had to put some gasket sealant around on the valve cover side,
right?
And then laid them in. And then I really had to wrench them down. I mean, the book was saying 90 inch pounds of torque on them.
That's about 7 foot pounds.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wasn't going to go that. That was scaring me.
You know what I did, Chris, with Mike Chevelle, the big block Chevelle? The same thing here. They were like a rubberized gasket, and they wouldn't stay conformed on the long side. They kind of bowed in. And I actually took a piece of wood and overlaid it and kind of clamped it with a couple of ice grips and let it set like that for about 20, 30 minutes.
Good idea.
Yeah.
But what I did was, I think one of the valve covers was kind of bent in a little bit. I had to get a vice grip and bend it out to avoid that from happening.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, there's so many times you used to take those stamped steel valve covers, invert them on the vise, and you had to straighten
them. Tippy-tap
them, because the last guy, the Hulk, put them on. The Conan the Mechanic.
Yeah, tighten down, you little piece of crap.
90 foot-pounds, not inch pounds.
Right. He's putting them on with an impact gun.
This goes to 11.
Yeah. So I didn't want to go through that because I didn't feel like snapping any of those little tiny stupid 3/8 bolts.
Smart. Yeah. Oh, that's definitely.
Although I gotta say, out of all the bolts you could break on an engine, I found valve cover bolts are usually the easiest to remove because they're drenched with oil.
Right.
Yeah.
There's
true.
Oil in the threads, but that's good. You avoided that. That's smart.
And that's another thing I wanted to bring up.
What?
Using a 3/8 inch socket. When was the last time, well, you guys did, but when was the last time any normal mechanic has ever used SAE tools?
Nobody
used it. I found moss growing on one of them. I think it was the 7/16. I'm like, what is this?
Right, yeah. But let's face it, a lot of mechanics these days, like, I know there's one guy, he's got the American drawer. It's just like one drawer in this box, it's a larger drawer with just like random American sizes in there, you know, wrenches, sockets, whatever, and he never goes in there.
No, I bought a set of impact sockets off the tool truck a couple weeks ago, and I said, I want the American ones. He goes, American? We don't, like, yeah, I get, he's like, I got to get them for you. And then Mike, setting up his new toolbox, he opened the big drawer, and he says, this half is American, this half is metric. I'm like, well, that's going to change, because you're going to need a drawer for each.
Yes. You know?
Exactly. I'm trying to figure out the conversions. Right now, I've figured out that 3/8 equals 11 millimeter.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
Yeah, and a half is usually like 12 or 13, depending on the,
right,
on the wrench.
Right, it's a little bit bigger, right?
Yeah.
12 is a little bit bigger than a half.
It depends on the socket or wrench. You know, you get leeway. Yeah. Yeah, there's a couple of crossovers.
There's a little bit of variation there, but yeah, if you're in a pinch, yeah, you could. 14's kind of sort of a 9/16 if you kind of smack it. 13's pretty good, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And it all depends.
So it's the parts that are assumed to fit by people that will make these assumptions that were not born when these cars were actually manufactured.
Right.
I'll talk to Joe about that. Road.
Yeah.
I'll give you one more dumb story, and then I'll let you guys talk to Star-Tron guy. one more story. I had to take the power window motor out of the passenger side door. I had to take that motor out.
Right.
You know, if you're familiar with the power window motors from the 60s, they had a gear affair in there where there were three small gear plugs that acted like shock absorbers that were pretty much were sacrificial lambs so the motor wouldn't get destroyed or the gears wouldn't get chewed up.
Right.
But eventually those plugs disintegrate.
Yep.
Right?
And now you got all kinds
of stuff. So I go online and I buy the gear that has the springs in them.
Oh.
Ooh. springs instead of the plugs. I'm thinking, this is a great idea. I love this.
How high-tech.
So now I spend literally the entire day yesterday trying to get that gear to fit into the motor itself. And then take that and put that in the car. So now I mount the motor back in the car with the new spring gear, and I send the window up. The window goes up once, comes down, goes back up, and then I hear brrrr.
That was your stomach.
Want to hear that again?
Yeah, go on.
Yep. I still have the wrench in my hand.
Oh, jeez.
I go to take the motor out. I look at the motor. The gear had stripped completely.
Oh.
The teeth on the gear had stripped completely.
Oh,
so I'm like, gah! Got to go back. Then I go to, literally, I got to go to Advanced Auto, had to go to a chain store, and I had to go to the help section. When was the last time anybody, anybody was on the help section?
Hey, you usually stop there to check your phone or like, say, excuse me,
right.
Where's the bathroom?
Where's the oil?
Yeah.
You look, right, you look at all the goofy things that they're selling on the help section, and one of them are those little plugs.
Really?
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
I couldn't believe it. I bought the little plugs.
That's kind of cool.
And then to put those in took another 2 hours and then get the motor in. I had the motor in and running by about 11 o'clock last night.
Nice.
At least you get to close the window.
Yeah.
Right.
But the top is down.
And the top is down. So all the windows are down and the top is down.
Oh, that's great. That's good.
But hey,
so there's my tales of woe.
So listen, we got something here that, of course, our studio and show manager, Robbie Leonard, is sitting. He's listening in on a call, by the way.
Yes.
Oh, Chris!
There's an article in today's Daily News. I was going to send this to you later on. It's about a guy who had a 71 Caddy sitting on the street for years, and it's just been, you know,
Brooklyn.
It hasn't moved. The end line in the thing says, that car is a staple in this community, said Jake, who was a note in the article. Those who gawk at it and want to get rid of it aren't real Brooklynites.
That's
so,
for sure.
Rob asked me if this was your car. I'll send you this later.
Forget
you
one?
Gotta see it. Yeah, this is one you may want to pick up. I know it's a.
No, okay. Suitable for framing? Can I frame this?
Yes.
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 It'd make an excellent, you know, like a jetty. Too bad you don't have waterfront property. You can use it as like a jetty.
Right.
Because like as a movable object, it's kind of gone there. But we get those in Queens too. Yeah, you know, like I was saying, right? Yeah, we got a guy with a Mark 7 and a humpback Seville. Just sitting there, you know.
Just right behind, sitting there.
Just sitting there, decrepitating, because, you know, as a matter of fact, I need a couple, we could use a couple of the Mark 7 parts for one of the cars at the UD. But,
yeah.
You know,
right.
trying to approach the guy, you know.
Yeah, because they're going to restore it one day. Yeah.
Yes,
no, you,
exactly.
You approach the car at 2 a.m. is what you do.
Yes.
There was, I remember, off of Cotelia Road in Brooklyn, there are a bunch of old turn-of-the-century houses, and sitting there was, ironic, I'm looking at a 69 Chrysler right now as I'm speaking to you, but there was a 70 Chrysler 300H, which was the gold and white heritage thing that they only put out 1 year with Hearst.
Right, Hearst.
Yeah, it was sitting there on four flats, and it literally had debris all around it, and it was parked in between two driveways in front of someone's house. And I drive by it with Dawn, and I'm like oogling at it, and she's like, "What is that? What is that? Clownmobile? What is that?" I'm like, "No, that's one of the greatest cars in the world. Are you kidding me?"
It's a 300.
And literally, it was like the car sat there. It looks like it was sitting there for 20 years.
Right.
And I don't know what happened to it, but I'm sure the guy got a lot of knocks on the door.
Yeah, that car's worth a fortune today.
Yeah, sure. They sure are. And it is amazing. I roll the green tub out of the garage, and I leave it in front of the garage, and I'm just, you know, playing with it and, you know, fixing things. And it's amazing. People come up, I turn around, there's someone staring there. There's no one in this neighborhood. This car attracts old middle-aged men.
I know you dread the green tub out, but when do you take the car out?
Are you sure?
You know, I tell you, I've been driving my Pontiac this weekend, and I was out at Rolling Thunder yesterday, and guys are coming in. And, you know, just I'm sitting there talking with Gerard, and they come in, "Hey, who owns a Pontiac and who owns a goat in the parking lot?" Like, and I said, "Oh," I still talking. I said, "Yo, Gerard did. He just bought it." And Gerard's like, and he's like, "He's pointing at me. No, it's his." And, you know, it just, the cars, older cars just start conversations. It's
they
really
sure
cool.
do.
Yeah, they bring back memories.
Speaking of older and big cars, Chris, the guys from the T-Bird Club, the Long Island T-Bird Club, and the T-Bird Owners of New York, otherwise known as
Tony.
Tony.
They pass on their conveyances of joy and elation and greetings to you last week. They're having their show today from 9 to 3 out at 58 Indian Head Road in Kings Park, and their charity is Building Homes for for Heroes.
Isn't that where they got the gasket-making, sealer-making?
Indian Head Road, right. They've asked us if we'll do a remote from there next year, and we may just do it.
Oh, hell yeah.
That would be fantastic.
So we'll be calling you in.
That would be way cool.
Yes, yeah, because I can't think of a better show to do a remote from. Those guys, Elliot and Dennis do a fantastic job, and the show's always a hit. So.
Right, absolutely.
What better show to do a remote from?
Absolutely.
Hell yeah.
Awesome.
All right, well, we're going to run because we have Jim Lindsey trying to get through, and we'll catch up to you again soon, Chris.
Sounds good. Talk to you soon. Thank you, gentlemen.
Take care.
All right.
Bye.
So long.
Bye. That was freaking great.
That was our old co-host, Chris Switzer, on the phone. Yes. And we're going to now take a quick break, and then we'll hopefully come back with Jim Lindsey from Star-Tron at Starbright. And we'll be back in a minute. Keep it where you got it on WHPC 90.3.
WHPC wants to let you know that Nassau Community College, along with the New York Blood Center and Long Island Blood Services, will be sponsoring the 25th annual Midsummer Blood Drive on Thursday, July 18th, from 9:30 a.m. until 2 p.m. in the multi-purpose room of the College Center building. With many donors on vacation and blood shortages anticipated throughout the region, this is a critical period to make an effort to participate in the drive. Blood donors must be 17 years old or older and in good health. More information is available online at ncc.edu.
This show is brought to you by the Neenan Healing Arts Center, an acupuncture establishment located in Belmore. Acupuncture is a natural and drug-free pain solution. Neenan Gilbert is a licensed New York acupuncturist with a certification in Chinese herbology. More information about the Neenan Healing Arts Center can be found by calling 516-442-7408 or by visiting NINANHealing.com.
We're back from Drag City on Motormouth Radio, and we're going to the phones, and we're saying hi. You're on with the Motormouths.
Hi there.
Hey, it's Bill Lindsey with Starbright.
Hey, Bill, what's happening?
How are you?
Happy Sunday. How are you guys doing?
Yes, we are doing fantastic.
Soaking in the sunshine.
And it's great to have you on the
Star-Tron.
I tell you, it's great to have you on once again because this is the season. I got to say, every season is the season for Star-Tron and Starbright products.
Yeah. But you guys got some great stuff.
But now especially, it's just, you know, I always see it kind of ramps up in the summertime because people are finding out they didn't store their products correctly. And they need to, you know, their gas powered equipment, and they want to revive it. And you know, we turn them on to the stuff all the time. So,
yeah,
the fuel ages. Whether you're using 100% ethanol free gas or if you're using an ethanol blend, it ages, and you've got to do something to mitigate the oxidation. And you've got to do more than just stabilize it. And happily, we can do that.
Absolutely. Yeah. Tell us a little bit how that, because it looks like, you know, black science to us, but how does that actually work?
Well, first off, let me say I was so excited about calling in that I went and got a haircut.
Oh, jeez.
So I appreciate that.
You know what? We could say, yeah, it looks pretty good. Yeah.
You look fantastic.
I've been told I have a face for radio, so there you go.
You and us both, right?
What do you think we're doing here?
Star-Tron is one of those things where people look at it, they read the label, go, there's no way you can do any of this stuff. And we say, you know what? We back up every single thing on there. Plus that, here's the 5-second overview. It's a blend of enzymes. Those are what do all the work. It's in a fuel base. Some of the enzymes are going to stabilize the fuel for up to 2 years. Some of them are going to help improve the combustibility. They allow more oxygen to attach to the hydrocarbon, which is gas or diesel, which just means that the engine starts easier, runs smoother, you get less emissions, you get less deposits. Plus, more importantly, with a more complete burn of the fuel charge, and this is what we all want, you get more power. The right. Fuel's more efficient. So
more power.
Exactly. Yeah. Plus, it also, some of the other enzymes, and like I said, there's a ton of them in there. some of the other enzymes are helping to go after any debris that's in the fuel itself, varnish, gum, what have you. Some of the others are going after any gunk that might be in the fuel delivery system, be it carburetor or injectors. When we had Hurricane Irma come through here a year and a half ago in South Florida, I was like Johnny Appleseed running up and down the street here, getting my neighbor's generators going. The guy next door, true story, Honda EU1000, little red, couldn't get it started, 32 poles. He's ready to throw it in the pool. I walk over. I said, just step away from the machine. I put half a bottle of Star-Tron, a little 8-ounce bottle, put half of it straight into a little fuel tank in this thing, prime it slowly three times, and don't touch it. Went home, got a can of starter fluid, came back, shot in a carburetor. First pole, hacked and wheezed. Second pole, it caught. It was running, but for 7 minutes. It was blowing white smoke like something out of a movie set, which I thought was kind of cool. But then he flipped the switch. At 7 minutes, I kid you not, it was purring perfectly, and his jaw hit the ground and said, what just happened? I said, A, I cleaned your carburetor, and B, we made that skunky fuel burn. Yeah. And it was just, it was running like nobody's business.
That's fantastic. You know, I got to say, I have my own testimonials because I've used it on my own stuff. And now I'm at the point where I just store the thing, the equipment correctly. So I just took my pressure washer out of storage. It was 2 years I hadn't used it. And I had stored it like I usually do with the snowblowers. I ran it. And as it was running dry of fuel that's treated with Star-Tron, I dumped raw Star-Tron right into the tank and let that be the last thing that motor breathed and burned.
Yep.
And now when I took it out and I put fresh gas in it, 1, 2, 3 pulls, boom, started up, no drama, and just then I had to do pressure washing for hours on end. So thanks, Bill.
Yes.
Sorry about that.
Yeah.
That's some great stuff. We've used it on a couple of Dragons at the UD. That old Corvette, we ran that through there, the Nova. You know, you could tell when, like, these cars have been sitting for a long time, and the gas just, you know, when you get them to start, they just stink!
Oh, yeah, it's very varnishy, yeah.
Yeah, and then it's a really wonderful smell. And then the Star-Tron really does a great job of cleaning stuff up. I mean, you know, it's better than the stuff that we were using, which usually comes in quart bottles and has, yeah, Jack, you know, says Jack Daniels.
This is Jack. Yeah. You know, Bill, one of the things that I was very happy to see, I stopped at my friend's, a good friend's local motorcycle shop yesterday, and I was sitting at the counter talking with some of the guys like I usually do, and right in front of me were two bottles of Starbright products, you know, some of the motorcycle products. I said, hey, see this stuff? We're going to have this guy in the show tomorrow. And they're like, wow, really? You know what? I'm like, oh, yeah. So we got to put in reams of paperwork together.
We're best known for our boat products, but the boss and I ride motorcycles. He's got four of them. I've got one. Right. You can guess which one of us is married.
Yeah, right.
but Ed up there, Suburban Harley, is a good friend of ours. He's helped us develop a couple of the appearance products we have. We've got a product called Bike Guard, which is a spray detailer. So after riding out and killing bugs, you come back, spray the bike down with that, wipe it off, takes the bugs off, the road dirt, makes it nice and shiny. And the best thing is it smells like blueberries. So if you have a hot date, you can just spritz yourself with a Bike Guard, and oh boy, I cannot vouch for your safety because the ladies will go wild over it.
Yeah, especially if they like pie.
Exactly. The thing is, we make a lot of appearance items for boats, and a lot of them, they cross over into the car market, the bike market, the Extreme Clean. And I know you guys have used that. It's not a soap, and part of the problem is some of the cleaners that you can get is your bike shop, your car shop, whatever, they're a little bit caustic, and you've got to be careful getting the stainless or polished aluminum or whatever. Whereas our Extreme Clean, our chemist made this, it's what's called a chelating agent. It's not a soap. A chelating agent breaks the bond between the dirt and the surface, so you spray it on the surface like the bike. I come back, I killed a bunch of love bugs. We have those all over the place down here this time of year. Spray it on the bike, let them soak in 5 minutes or so, then just wipe it off. Takes them right off, doesn't hurt the paint, the chrome, the wrap, anything, and just a nice clean surface behind. And then you can wash it if you want, you can spray it with Bike Guard, whatever, but it's good for tools. I use it to clean the my wheels of my cars with the brake dust and all that stuff. It's just good stuff.
You know, speaking of that, I keep a bottle of Extreme Clean in my garage, and I've used that to clean brake dust off the wheels where I ran out of the typical brake dust cleaner, and it worked. And just the other day, like I said, with pressure washing, I want to just amp up my soap solution because the concrete got kind of black and really kind of mucky. And I said, you know what? give me that extreme clean. I dumped the bottle into the bucket that I was extracting the soap from. And let me tell you, it made a nice frothy mix on the concrete and cleaned it. And it smelled very nice, too. It was great.
Nice. And it's not caustic. So you're not spraying bleach or acid or something else that's going to hurt the surface that you're cleaning or you.
Right.
Hey, we need every customer we have.
Sure.
So we want the products to be easy to use and not eat you up.
Absolutely.
But they work. We here's the thing. We make our products and we use them. We're not a bunch of bean counters. So the products have to work. Otherwise, we're going to complain like little girls. But we tend to over-engineer everything we make. We use everything we make, and we stand behind it. If anybody has questions, they can call us, and we'll walk them through what the solution might be.
Right. It's nice to know that you're not just sitting there buying a bunch of stuff from God knows what other country across the ocean there and just say, hey, buy this stuff. It doesn't work good. Well, don't ask me. We'll have to go send the carrier pigeon to
yeah, go check a fortune cookie for the
mm-hmm.
answer.
There you go.
That's very true. And the website is starbright.com is very inclusive. There's, like I said earlier, your online catalog is just voluminous. It's a ton of stuff. And, of course, a lot of boat stuff, which, you know, we're up here on Long Island, so there's a ton of boats over here as well.
Yeah, we got some water here.
Yeah.
Sure.
Good stuff.
It works on the cars, too. I use the boat wash to clean the cars. And then I use the premium marine polish on my cars. I don't use a wax. A wax, if you get 3 months out of it, you're doing great. That's just physics. That's all the wax it lasts with. Not knocking waxes.
Right.
We make a carnival wax, but whatever. A polymer polish actually bonds to the surface, so you get at least 8 months out of it. You get super shine. Nothing sticks to it. It protects against UV. Makes cleanup super easy. A lot of the boat stuff has crossovers to your car, your truck, your bike, your RV as well.
What's the application technique for that stuff?
It's super simple. You clean the whatever it is, and you can put it on paint, polished metal, fiberglass. Just make sure it's clean, make sure it's dry. Put a little bit on the cloth, do the Mr. Miyagi application, mm-hmm. circular overlapping motions, a little bit. Don't go crazy with it. It's going to dry to a haze in about 15, 20 minutes or so. Come back, just kind of lightly, you don't even buff, you're kind of wiping it off. You got a super shine right there. And it's, again, on paint, on my cars, one of them's an 03, and I promise you, it looks like it just rolled out of the factory yesterday. And it's a dark color, so it's super shiny, nice and clean. For that, I'll put a carnauba on top of the polymer, knowing I have to redo it every 2 months or so, but it gives a lot of depth.
Right.
But I don't use just wax on cars or boats because it's why? You put so much time into it, you get 3 months out of it? I don't think so. Polymers
like
are the way
technology.
To go.
That's
yep.
great. What would be really cool is if that product had a slight purple hue, then it would be a purple haze. All right? And we can all do some
I will talk to the chemist tomorrow.
Yeah, okay. We'll all play some air guitar while we're putting that stuff on.
On the other hand, there may be some of us, there'd be some people out there that might want to lick it.
Yeah, true.
So,
you know.
In which case, they'll be sprawled on the hood for one reason or another.
Our friend, our friend Matt Goban Brian wants to know if he heard you correctly when you said, did you say Star-Tron could be used in a diesel application as well?
Star-Tron can be used in any fuel. Now, we have a gas formula, we have a diesel formula. The gas formula, it gets confusing, so stay with me. The original one, 1 ounce treats 16 gallons. It's for boats. My boat's got a 125-gallon fuel tank, so I get an 8-ounce bottle, I dump it in, I'm done. But then the Harley, the lawnmower, whatever, it's a little tank. I have a 6-gallon tank in a garage I used to fuel them from, and people were making themselves crazy trying to measure a fraction of an ounce. So we had the chemist just come out with a version which 1 ounce treats 6 gallons. It's right on. We make the bottles at our plant in Alabama. We make everything in Alabama. Bottles, we blend everything, ship it all over the world. But you have to look at the bottle you're holding, flip it around the back. It'll tell you what to use. Then there's a diesel formula, that super heavy-duty Star-Tron. My wife's got a diesel SUV, a little Volkswagen Touareg with the evil diesel engine. And we run Star-Tron diesel in that. 1 ounce for 32 gallons. This thing just it pockets along. There's no soot coming out of it. You get full power. And with diesel fuel, you got to be careful, too, because you get a 5 to 15% biodiesel. And in the Volkswagen, Porsche, Audi engines, you can't run more than 5% biodiesel, or you risk voiding your warranty, which is a very seriously bad thing. So the Star-Tron helps improve the quality of the fuel, makes it burn better, cleans up any gunk that might be in there, keeps it stabilized. So, yeah, there's a Star-Tron for anything that runs on fossil fuel.
That is excellent. That is very
good
cool.
Good to know.
Yeah, that's yeah. Well, that kind of sums that one up.
If you have a Tesla, you can show it an empty Star-Tron bottle. And we understand it'll rev better. We haven't tested that yet, but we've heard that.
Oh, we'll have to give that a shot. That's cool.
Okay. We'll go out in the parking lot later. We'll see what happens. The owner of the car may not like it too much, but that's okay.
Right.
There's some pretty good bushes we could hide in once we jump in.
Yeah. Have you gotten any horror stories through the through the tech line or whatever from people who have really had any like above and beyond nastiness that they had to deal with?
We had a guy calling from Hawaii, and it's funny because he keeps calling back with updates. He found an old Karmann Ghia in a wrecking yard over there, and he wanted to restore it. In the fuel tank, he said it looked kind of like syrup in there, like maple syrup. And we walked him through. We actually had him using E10 because the ethanol is a good solvent. So we had him using a couple of gallons of E10 and a massive overdose of Star-Tron, had him let it soak and slosh it a little bit. He called back later. He said he had to do it twice. But he said now the fuel tank looks great, so he can reuse that because he couldn't get a new fuel tank in his car.
Yeah.
So he's happy with that. We get a lot of people that have older vehicles that have been sitting in storage, or like we had a couple guys that had a barn find of a Buick they got, and they just basically dumped a whole bottle of Star-Tron in there, and that thing cranked right. They put fresh fuel in, cranked it right up, so it was running great. Yeah. One of my injectors was clogged. I dumped the entire bottle of Star-Tron in, took it on the highway, spooled it up a little bit. And 4.5 years later, it's still running perfectly. So it's good stuff.
Beats the heck out of having to yank the injector or replace it or something like that, yeah.
You know, last
my tech now uses it.
Yeah, right.
Because he was upset he was going to charge me $300 to clean the injector, and it came in perfect. He's like, what'd you use? And I gave him the stuff, and we actually had that engine bored out for a little bit more power. And he was flabbergasted by how clean everything was inside as he's taking it apart. He actually had me come over to the shop, which I thought was going to be an expensive visit.
Uh-huh.
And he's like, everything's spotless. He goes, I can't figure it out. This stuff, it works. What the hell's in it?
Yeah. I was using some at the shop a while ago. And there was a guy who came in. We were talking a little bit. And he said, you know, what are you doing? I gave him the rundown. And I just pointed because last year you sent us a banner. And we hung it on the wall. And I said, that stuff right there. And he says, ooh, that's a nice banner. I'm like, yeah, it's nice and blue. It's kind of summer, you know.
Yeah.
So I know the guy. So I turned him on to a bottle of my own stash that I carried in the trunk of my car that I was going to use for Phillips. I said, yeah, take this, use it. If you like it, you know, continue on. It's all you got to do is use it, and you'll be a believer. I haven't talked to him again, so I don't know what happened, but I'm sure he was...
well, at least he didn't come gunning for you.
No, well, because I would have known that too, right?
Yeah, like you know how stuff comes back to bite you, like a Seinfeld episode, you know?
Right.
See, so obviously something went well.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, that's a good thing, Joe, when
that's
you...
That's a New York compliment, when they don't yell at you.
Yeah. But when we, you know, when we endorse a product and tell people about a product that we know works, you got a high probability rate that you're not going to get hit in the back of the head with a 2x4 in
right.
a week. You know? And again, I would say, hey, because
they take the empty bottle and wing it at you, something like that. You know, make it a Molotov cocktail, or
right,
something like
right,
that.
Right, right.
Hey, this stuff burns good. Here, let me throw it at you. See, yeah. No, you actually got rave reviews in that regard from us.
Absolutely.
About through us, I should say.
Yeah.
Yeah. I see we got some other stuff. Your carbon eliminator?
We do. We look at what's out there to see what's in the market and see. We turn our chemist list. This guy is brilliant. He's so talented. It's amazing.
What?
And he came out with the carbon eliminator. There's one that's an aerosol form, and then there's another one, the ring clean plus, that you just put into the fuel itself.
Okay.
And basically, there's other products that have been out there, and he looked at them, and he said, they're good. There's nothing wrong with what's out there, but some of the compounds, the ingredients go back to what was new and exciting 15, 20 years ago. I said, there's new stuff out now. Plus, we can put some of the enzymes from Star-Tron in and just have a really effective product. So we turned them loose, and he came out with some really good stuff, and we're getting very good responses from people using it. They're saying, we like the fact that it works great, and apparently there's a little bit of a price advantage in that, too. I've not priced it, so I couldn't tell you that. But
right.
That's one of the happy calls we've gotten as well. Like, hey, it works and it saves me money.
Right.
Can't beat that combination.
I know a few years ago I had done a dopey thing and I did not. I have a backpack air blower that I was using and I let it sit and it went a little longer than I should have and I didn't have the gas. It's a two-stroke and I figured I would use the gas up and store it. And as things happen, things happened, and I didn't. And the next season, it didn't want to full throttle or whatever. I brought it into the repair center to have these guys look at it. And he says, you know what happens is the piston gets all gunged up and carbon. He says, and yeah, because you probably didn't do the right thing. So he called me back in about 2 days later, and the tech came out and said, yeah, that's exactly what happened. And he showed me, he says, you got to use Echo. The Echo two-stroke oil we want you to use because it's they like that the best. It's their brand. He goes, and this stuff. And he showed me a bottle of Star-Tron, and I felt about like a micro-inch tall. I'm like, you don't understand. He goes, I have that stuff at home. I said, and then I tried to explain how, listen, I thought the thing was going to be done with the fuel, but it wasn't. And I said, listen, all right, guilty. Just shoot me now. No problem. I gave him $100 to fix the thing. And mm-hmm. since then, it's, but so these guys do endorse it. The places who know absolutely know that the stuff is primo.
That's always kind of cool when you don't give them any kind of prompting and like all of a sudden they whip something out that you're familiar with the product. Oh, those guys.
Right. Now, what we want to do, Bill, is we want to get some of this stuff, some of this product in the hands of our listeners.
Mm-hmm.
So what we're going to do is have them, I'll put this out, and I'll put it out on social media, too. If they contact us via our Twitter page or our Instagram page or the website, or they could email us, go to our website, motormouthradio.com, and they can email us. We will see that they get some product. And I know last time we did this, it was wild. So I was mailing stuff for about 3 months. So we're gonna do that at your gracious behalf because you were nice enough to offer to get this stuff out into people's hands. And I think it's kind of like it's almost like a no-brainer. It's like, you know, you give the guy the candy and you know he's going to come back for more. So it's a great advertising campaign because I think once people use this stuff, they're gonna be hooked on it and they're gonna continue to buy it. So that's our goal, is to help get you guys, you know,
spread the word.
Absolutely.
We very much appreciate that, guys. Thank you.
Oh, yes, absolutely. It's like I said, we like to align ourselves with the guys who do it right, and we certainly believe that you and your company are some of those guys who do it right. So that's why we do that. So, and I always remember the story you told about hurricane season a few years ago. It was probably now about 5-6 years ago with your generator.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've actually recounted that story about how you had a little tete-a-tete with your wife about the getting the generator ready because the hurricane was coming. I think she was like,
"Oh yeah, it's one of it because you never run your generator as much as you're supposed to." I mean, I actually ran them 2 weeks ago, which kind of surprised me because I'd run them a year ago.
Yeah.
But normally you just ignore it until it's ready to go, and then it's like, "Oh crap, the thing, is it going to start or not? The power's out, and the wife's cranky at you." But this stuff, it just, because it stabilizes so well, and we've got tests on every single claim we make, by the way. We back everything up. It stabilizes it, and we say 2 years. We've had stories of people having fuel three years old and still running great, but because it helps make the fuel more combustible as well, it's kind of a 1-2 punch, because if that fuel has any kind of oomph left in it, and you get a spark going, 9 times out of 10, this will get the engine running, and then while it's running, it cleans out the gunk of the carburetor or injectors, whatever it may be. So it cleans it up, and then you top it off with fresh fuel, and you're off to the races. So it's a marriage saver.
Yeah.
Seriously, yeah.
Hey, and there's nothing wrong with that. You know, that's great.
No.
And it's a blue bottle, so it's friendly. So it's instead of a blue pill, you got a blue bottle. It's it all works well. Excellent.
Blue is the color.
My wife is a transplant from Long Island.
Yeah.
So you know how they can be if they get cranky. So if I have a product that helps make her happy, then God bless.
Absolutely. We do understand that 110%. Yeah. Now, how long has she been down there with you in the sunny state?
She came down here about right out of high school, so like 25 years ago, never went back. And I'm happy. She's a wonderful little person.
Beautiful. That's great.
She's probably listening, and she is the love of my life. And best thing I ever did was marry you, sweetheart.
That's great. And we say hi from Long Island because we're still grinding it out up here.
Star-Tron. And she uses all the products around the house. We've got the dogs. We've got a product called Performicide. It actually kills odor and odor-causing bacteria, mold and mildew. It's EPA registered.
Wow.
So we have some cool stuff. Your listeners should go on the radio go on the website, check us out, and if any questions, call up and ask for me. I'll do my best to walk them through it.
And that website is?
Starbright.com, S-T-A-R, BRITE.com. Ask for Bill.
Yeah, and we'd use some nose guard a few years ago, and that stuff worked great, too.
there you go.
All right, Bill, we thank you very much, and we'll be in touch as always. We thank you for coming on with us on this Sunday.
Much appreciated.
Hopefully we'll get great feedback from this, and we'll be...
Go to their website. The website's crawling with great stuff. So,
absolutely.
You know,
yeah, whether you're a boat, car, motorcycle guy. Yeah.
By all means.
Something for everyone, absolutely. Cool.
All right, guys, take care.
Thanks, Bill. Talk to you soon.
Bye-bye.
That was Bill from Starbright. We had a great...
Better living through Kevin. No, sorry.
Yeah,
no,
well...
Wrong motto.
Yeah.
Wrong company.
Well, I tell you what you can. If you want to use that product and when you have to wait for it to set in and do its cleaning, you can listen to Oasis tonight. Well, Sundays. I'm sorry. It's not tonight. It's this morning at 7 a.m. So not today. You can probably go on iHeartRadio or Spreaker and find it. Host Victoria Crosby presents New Age, Light Jazz, and Classical Music along with poetry readings. So that's a good way to start that early Sunday a.m. But cool. For now, we're going to take another break. We're going to go to, like Bill was talking about, the customer from Hawaii who restored that Carmen gear. Let's go see if we can find him. I think I heard that thing puttering out in a parking lot. And we'll take care of a little bit of business. Here on Motor Mouth Radio. Ray Guarino, Joe D. will be back in a minute on 90.3 WHPC.
This is Rita Monte. Would you like to take a trip to romantic Italy with me? Let's go together every Thursday with Profumi d'Italia. You will hear and savor Italy's soul with music from yesterday and today. Learn about Italy's museums, countryside, restaurants, festivals, and wineries. Most of all, you will learn about Italy's history and its people. Thursdays at 5 p.m., experience the essence of Italy on the Voice of Nassau Community College 90.3 WHPC.
This show is brought to you by On the Road Again Motorcycle School. Hi, I'm Steve Bertolini, the president of On the Road Again Motorcycle School, and I'd like to tell you that life is short, so live a little by learning how to ride a motorcycle. Classes are available from beginner riders to advanced, including private lessons. Lessons are offered on the campuses of Nassau Community College and Suffolk Community College, also offering the license waiver class, where you can skip the DMV. More information about On the Road Again Motorcycle School can be found by calling 631-862-RIDE. That's 631-862-RIDE. Or online at lrn2ride.com.
Shake off the realities of the day, broaden your musical horizons, and embrace the diversity every Monday evening at 6 on Revelations. The show offers a potently unique collection of music with an emphasis on themes and rock rarities. An occasional tour de force of blues and soul mixed with compelling sets of folk and folk rock. I'm Steve Kay, and I've got the perfect soundtrack for your drive home every Monday evening at 6 on Revelations. Right here. Here on the Voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
You are listening to Motormouths, Ray Guarino and Joe D, a.k.a. the Vultures of Automotive Culture, coming your way every Sunday, right here on the Voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC, from 12 noon to 1 p.m., these guys know their stuff. You got a problem with your car? Call in and the Motor Mouths will help you with the solution in a very informative and sometimes comical way. Every Sunday from 12 noon to 1 p.m., you can also check them out at motormouthradio.com.
Yes, Joe is cresting the wave over here, surfing back into the studio.
Yes, I was
Usually he has a long neck base, but he's got a long board today, and here he comes with his board shorts.
You don't want to get the base wet.
That was very good of you, very good. We are back, Motormouth Radio, and...
I was out with Dano booking him.
Go book him, buddy. Right, your host, Ray Guarino, Joe D. We're here for another live segment. You can get a hold of us at 516-572-7440 if you want to get in on this fun and talk about... Well, anything we've been talking about or any new stuff. And in the meantime, you know, Bill Lindsey was talking about carburetors on cars and motorcycles that gummed up, and Star-Tron helps fix it. I got a tool. You know, here's something that, Joe, you'll probably recognize that from the carburetor days. It's a piece of brass, a cylindrical hunk of brass. And what that is, that's out of a
seat.
That's a quadrajet. That's a seat that the needle goes in a quadrajet carburetor. And I've never had a screwdriver blade that was wide enough to actually get in there.
Oh, yeah. That's a good point. Yeah.
Oh, look what I got.
Of course.
I happen to...
Snap on to the rescue.
You know, I happen to see something on Instagram where they showed... it was a snap-on screwdriver that was made for a brass plug removal. It looked like a Holley fuel-level plug.
Yeah, because that's another pain in the butt.
And it was for a marine application. So I showed it to the tool dealer. And he says, no, I never saw this. So he comes up with this screwdriver. It's a beefy mother humper, man. This thing is...
Yeah, look at this thing.
Spot on, right? I think the shaft is half inch.
I mean, it's a good size handle. We got to put a picture out on this thing. It's a good size handle with a very short and fat shank to it, which means that, you know, they're expecting a good deal of torqueage out of this thing.
Right.
In other words, no reaching down in there trying to twiddle something out. No, this is like, you got to grab a handful of this.
I had actually said to him that I've never had a screwdriver that would work on that application. And he said to me, he goes, what about like an impact driver, a flat, you know, straight slot impact driver? I said, you know, I never thought of that. So I went home, I tried some of my impact drivers,
right.
and they did fit better. But I'm thinking I wanted a long one because that's kind of down in a recess.
That's a good point.
So
yeah.
I said, okay, if the screwdriver doesn't really fit, I'll go for the long impact driver.
Right.
And he came up with this thing, and I'm like, damn.
Pretty cool.
So there is hope for, you know, for all of us old carb jockeys that you
can... Yeah, that's pretty good. You know what I love? Because, you know, we do have that tool junkie habit thing, is that when you have friends that are doing a certain job, you know, they're working at their own place or whatever, and they go, you know, I bet you Ray has a tool for that, or I bet you Joe has that tool for that in his box someplace, you know what I mean? And we're those guys, pretty much, you know?
I've heard that many times over, like, I'm sure you got this, and sometimes I'm like, no, I don't, but I'm going to get one now.
Yeah, because, you know, when you're in the middle of trying to get something done, and it turns out you need a special tool
right.
that cannot be approximated with a vice grip or a torch or, you know, an air chisel.
Another perfect example was working on the brakes on that Dodge Ram.
Right.
The front pistons are dual piston design, and what I have is I have a couple of brake piston... compressors,
yeah.
Right. One of them is just a nice big plate with a screw, and the other one is the one you gave me that's like a scissor thing.
Right.
That works on the Wilwood pistons. But I had to use, on the dual pistons, you can't get the single one in line because the outside part of the piston has a center little wall.
Right.
And that's where the tool would go.
Mm.
So Mike at the shop has one, and I'm just going to have to buy this thing. It's like two plates on a screw with a handle, and you ratchet it.
Yeah, I've seen those. That's kind of cool, yeah.
I always got to flip it. It takes me like a couple seconds to get it oriented right and get the thread set up because one goes right, one goes left. But that's what you need for a dual piston design.
See, yeah, that's the thing these days. There's so many different brake designs as opposed to back in the day. It was like, okay, grab the one and just, you know, do what you got to do. But that's
C-clamp.
Yeah, exactly. But, man, that's pretty much gone with the wind.
So, again, there's always different ways of doing it. And if you want to, you know, if you're, I want to get these guys in. I want to mention a couple of shows that are coming up. Our own Centurion Cruisers, the 10th annual charity car show at... this is going to be
I can't see that from here, so I can't help you.
No, David Lerner Associates, July 21st from 9 to 3. That's David Lerner Associates, 477 Jericho Turnpike in Syosset.
Okay.
A charity show that benefits the Nassau Suffolk chapter of the Autism Society of America. And also on that date is LICOA, the Long Island Corvette Owners Association. This is the All Car and Truck Show at the Teachers Federal Credit Union. The donations fight ALS, again, the 21st, rain date the 28th, and this is on Motor Parkway out in Hopog. So hopefully we can get one of the guys from the show, from the club, and talk about that.
Yeah, if you're listening, guys, come on, talk it up.
Yeah.
Yeah, then you can get some Motormouth listeners.
Well, yeah, some of them are already.
Yes.
They had their
more Motormouth listeners.
Right, because you might have been at their other show today, like I was doing a show at the Vanderbilt, which is fantastic, the Vanderbilt Museum up in Centerport.
Mm.
That's going on right now. Registration from 7:30 to 10:30. But that was, how long do they go? See, that's the thing. I want to start a thing to make car show sheets uniform. So the date and the time, it's all kind of in the same place, because I can never find what I'm looking for. People use different size texts and whatnot. But anyway, that's going on now in Centerport. That's another great show.
Or they could shoot it to us in a uniform format.
And
we'll plug it.
And yeah, there is no uniformity. That's the problem.
Mm.
But
you're out of uniform, Sailor.
Out of uniform is right.
Yeah, well, you know, some of us just don't fit. You know, we're like the little misfit type of guys there.
Yeah.
But that's okay, because you know what? You can't. Everybody's not the same.
Yeah. So now I know you're working on a brake issue with one of your cars as well, that you have to do some further investigation.
Yeah, I had some funky noises. I got interrupted, but I pulled the wheel and like it looks like the brake pad is not contacting in a uniform circular pattern, which could be a lot of different things there. You know, so
yeah, you know, I think of either the rotor or the pressure that the caliper exerts on the pad.
Yeah. Yeah.
For two that come to mind, you know.
Yeah, so actually what I got to just rip it apart, see what's going on.
Right.
Yeah, because the other thing, too, is that depending on... I ended up actually doing this in my own driveway, which means I didn't have access to all my tools because, you know, you have the tools at the UD, you have the tools that are in the rolling toolbox, but those tend to be diagnostic tools. So... You know, the actual wrenches and stuff. I mean, you know, taking a tire off is no big deal. But, you
know. It was funny when I was talking to the tool guy about this screwdriver. He goes, yeah, I think I'll order something for you. And I said, you know, the problem with that's going to be. He's like, what? I said, I'm going to need three of them. He goes, what do you mean three? I said, I'm going to have one here at the shop. I'm going to have one at home. I'm going to have one at work. Because I do the same thing at like any one of those locations, and you know.
So that's your own version of Yang's rule of three.
Pretty much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, rather than one to have one for a spare and one for a spare for the other spare.
Well, what's good is like the stuff I have at work gets used less.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's not my main.
It's the backup.
My main work is in that field, and then the stuff in the field jobs get beat up a little more. But I got to tell you something, and I complained about this when Snap-on, well, they did it years ago. I'm just slowly updating. The screwdrivers are all this soft grip material,
right?
And it's red or green or yellow, whatever. But you use it like one or two times, even if you're not doing a particularly dirty job, and they get dirty.
Yes.
And I said, yeah, you know, I like my tools clean, and it doesn't wipe off. And he told me a trick. He says, get a can of WD-40. So yesterday I did that in the garage. I took out some of my newer pliers with the red grips, sprayed some WD-40, cleaned it with a rag, takes it right off.
It's a fine solvent. Yes,
it is. And one of the uses is for like removing glue. And I found out that if you have a piece of plexiglass that has a blue coating
that protective stuff.
And when it gets old, that sticks a little.
Right.
Well, sometimes it's like a brown, almost like a brown paper coating.
Right.
Spray it with WD-40.
Right.
And it'll loosen it up.
Lubricates it right off.
Absolutely. So, anyway.
Yeah, because, you know, let's face it, that's one thing. You know, it's nice when you actually see someone whose tools, while they're in good shape and not dripping with all kinds of fluids and whatnot, but they still have that used look to them.
Right.
It's like, oh, well, geez, I just bought this off the truck and I'll keep it there because it looks better. It looks good next to this one. No.
Yeah.
You use tools, you beat them up a little bit. You know, you don't abuse them, you don't misuse them, but you definitely want... You want to have a mechanic that looks like he actually uses his tools.
Yes.
You know, except for the hammer draw.
Yeah. Mike and I stopped at a shop that a friend of his is setting up in Limbrook.
Mm-hmm.
Nice. It used to be an Exxon. Now it's a Hess station. And as soon as we pulled up, a three-bay shop, the doors were open. I'm like, oh, I want to work here. Because I could see in the middle of the day, the place was white. The top of the walls were white with a green stripe like the Hess. Yeah, right?
Yes, right.
And it was bright. LED light, you could have half the lights and still have plenty of light. For us old guys, that's paramount.
Yes.
And the floor was this plasticky kind of grated material that it helps.
Yeah, that's kind of cool. Yeah. I mean, I have not experienced that stuff.
Easy on the feet, easy on the knees. And if you drop a tool, it doesn't get scratched on the concrete or roll across the, you know, three bays.
Yeah, goes and flying, yeah.
I said, wow, this is really, really nice. I mean, so it looked more like a dealership than a repair shop. He even took the new Hunter alignment machine. They kind of sunk it down so it's level with the floor surface. Beautiful.
Right.
Beautiful shop. So
it's nice to have a well-planned-out place rather than somebody just like disgorge an entire tool truck in there, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
You know, you plan out what things are, you have enough room, you're not playing, you're not falling all over each other. That's a big part of it these days because you need your room, you need your light, you need your safety.
Oh, it is. Absolutely.
Rather than just having some, you know, something with a roof over your head so you don't get rained on.
Yeah.
Although that is probably the main thing.
It's true, that too. Well, we're just about ready to get out of here.
Yeah, we fried another hour, right?
We do. There goes my phone.
Oh, yeah, that's not good.
We don't have a booking for next week yet, but that can change in a day or two.
Yes, you never know.
As it typically does.
No one expects the fill in the blank.
But we'll do something like that. So, yeah, for Motormouth Radio, Ray Guarino, Joe D, we'll see you next week.
Yes.
We'll come back, and hopefully we'll have a guest. And for now, stay tuned for Thunder Road. I know you do, because...
Yeah, we hear all about it. Yeah, we hang out with that Kim girl after this.
They complain when we're
so
on.
So hurry up,
not.
Get the hell off, yeah.
So that's it. We'll see you next week.
On WHPC.
Bye.